Honestly, I don't remember how long, but for a while now, I've been using Niri, a scrollable tiling wheeling compositor. This is built on the Smithy library, the same Smithy that System76 is using for their Cosmic Desktop. Weirdly though, it uses the GNOME portal for doing things like screen capture and all of the various portal things. It's an interesting design choice. The main reason for it is, well, it's a good portal, and the developer is used to working with GNOME tech, so it kind of just makes sense. For all the issues I might have with GNOME, the portal frankly isn't one of them. The portal is, it's a great portal. It's obviously using the whole limited beta stuff, and I don't like the look of it, but functionality-wise, totally fine portal. And maybe eventually I'll get around to doing a proper long-term thoughts on Niri, but today instead I want to talk about the Niri model, the scrollable tiling window manager, as I've been calling them, scrollers, because Niri is not the only one that does this. There are things like Carousel. This is a script for KDE Plasma. There is PaperWM. This is a plugin for the GNOME shell. There was HyperScroller. This is a plugin for Hyprland. This is now deprecated. Now there's another one, HyperScrolling. Make sure you don't get those confused, because this one is outdated and this one still actively being developed. And then there is Scroll, which is basically i3. It's Sway. It's on Wayland, so I guess Sway is a better comparison. And if you happen to be a macOS person, there is paperwm.spoon, which is a plugin for the Hammer Spoon system, whatever that is. I don't use macOS, but it's the same functionality. Now, I've been saying scroller and scrolling tiling window manager and scrolling window manager, but what is the model? What are we actually talking about here when I talk about a scroller? So, let's go to a new workspace. If I spawn a window, that window is going to be placed into a tile like you would see with a tiling window manager. I have it take up half the screen. That can be customized to whatever you want. If I spawn another one, that spawns into another tile. Now, normally in a tiling window manager, in something like an i3 or a Hyperland or a river or pick your poison, you'd spawn another window and then based on whatever algorithm it's using, whether it's manually being set by you or there's some sort of internal, hey, this is the layout we're using, the window would be spawned somewhere on this screen. It would probably cut this window in half or cut this window in half depending on the model, or maybe it would create something else that I don't have an idea for. Maybe you want to do like a triple column one, for example. That's a totally normal layout as well. Now, on a scroller, that's not what happens. Instead, I spawn a new window, and let's just put B top here so we can easily see it. And instead of being limited to what we have on the screen, on the viewport, we basically have an infinite horizontal plane. Now, if I don't want the window to be over there, I can move it back here, and now it's kind of like a tiler, and this is how I often use it. But we're not limited to just this. And we're not limited to just this. We can just keep going as much as I want, and really, the only thing that stops me is the resources on my system. Whilst you can do this, obviously there comes a point where it is mentally not manageable. There is a lot going on and it's just, it's too much to really understand in a way where you could reasonably use the system. So whilst you have the capability, in reality, you're going to want to limit yourself to something that you can personally handle. I don't know what that number's going to be. I don't know what that layout's going to be, but I can talk about it from my own perspective. Now, let's start with the good. Whilst I do like the general tiling model, and it is a big part of the reason that I started using Linux, the first thing I used on Linux was i3wm, and i3 is a manual tiler, but the thing I mainly enjoyed was things like BSPWM, Hyperland, AwesomeWM, the dynamic tiler model. Inherent to the model, there are going to be some annoyances. One thing you have to worry about is how many windows are on each workspace. Usually, a hard cap of 4. Anything more than this on a tiler is a little bit rough. Sometimes if you're just dealing with terminal windows, something like this is gonna be fine. And then maybe you can get away with this, for example. But for anything else besides the terminal, this is just not really viable. Usually you're gonna have something like, I don't know, a browser window and then something else. So you're typically limited to 2 and maybe 3 in some contexts. And when I'm researching a big video, I'm not the kind of person that likes to have a million tabs in one window. I know some people do that. You look at their tabs, it's like, how do you find anything? And I know you can use tree style tabs and tab groups and mitigate this problem, but I've kind of mitigated it at a different level. I just open up multiple browser windows. And when you're doing this with multiple workspaces, you very quickly start to run out of workspaces because realistically, you only have a certain number of keys to access those workspaces. And once you run out of those keys, accessing them becomes really inconvenient, or you might be on an environment where you can't dynamically generate things, so you actually have a hard limit for workspaces. On a scroller, you don't have that limitation. So if I want to just expand out as much as I want, I can do that. Now, I know I showed you this with the terminals, and obviously there's a limit to how viable this really is, but this is a thing I actually do using a scroller. And the workspaces are still there, so I can use the workspaces, but they serve a different function. I can have all of my research on the screen here, and then the workspace is used to display something different. So I can have my notes here, I can have a different topic I'm looking at that I'm sort of half researching, and it kind of changes the way you're handling grouping. Previously, the workspaces were the group, but now the workspaces are kind of a different context, if that makes sense. And again, this is just me. You don't have to work with this. You can use a scroller mostly how you would use a tiler and just have a little bit of extra space off to the side. That's totally fine as well. But it's something where now that I've been using it, I'm really used to it. And going to something that doesn't have it, honestly, would be kind of difficult for me. In that same vein, I don't usually just have the windows taking up half the screen. I usually like them to be full screen. And obviously, you can't do this with a tiler. Now, of course, you can go and say, oh, well, I want to full screen this window and then unfull screen that one, go over here and then full screen that one. But that's just an extra key press. And I don't want to have to deal with that. It kind of just eliminates that problem because I have as much space as I could possibly ever want, and I don't have to worry about a window being full screened. It's kind of just there, right? Like, it's just always full screen and it's always available. And again, of course you can do this with workspaces. I can have a full screen window here and a full screen window on the next one and the next one and the next one. But again, you very quickly run out of workspaces. And if you're the kind of person that likes to spread things out, a scroller really lets you do that in a way that nothing else lets you do so in a way that's manageable. Yes, you can spread things out on a floating environment, but then windows are overlapping each other and I'm not a fan of that. Speaking of full screen windows, there is a kind of window that basically always expects to be in that state. That is a game. Now, yes, you can technically run games in window mode, blah, blah, all this good stuff, but games, for the most part, are built around the full screen model, and they're built around windows, which kind of expects a floating environment and doesn't expect this thing, which is gonna force windows into a tile that they're not intended to be in. So I've noticed that games tend to behave weirdly on tilers. This isn't just an individual thing. Basically all of them, if you ever tab out of the game, if you ever do anything that lets the tiler take control, some games just kind of break. And when you force a game into a lower resolution, into a tile, some of them don't know what to do. But on Niri, there is always space to be in full screen because all the window needs to do is expand to the viewport and there's infinite space to work with. So here we have trails in the sky, and this is just a random example. The game is in full screen, everything behaves correctly, but I'm still on Niri. So I can just spawn a window to the side, and Niri is still magically keeping this window behaving correctly. And I can just go between it, and because the game still thinks it's in a full screen area, it doesn't break. It doesn't force itself into a tile, it doesn't do anything weird. It just works. And of course, on a regular tile, you can always just spawn the game on a blank workspace and basically have the same effect, but you don't know how many times I've tried to open a game on a workspace that has a tiled window on something like i3, on something like Awesome, and the game tries to spawn in the tile. And I'm like, why are you doing this? Stop doing it. And you can usually fix it with window rules and say every game that spawns, you usually have to do it game by game, unless you spawn them in GameScope. Every single game, just spawn it in a floating or automatically full screened, and the problem usually goes away. But even so, I don't have to think about it. I can just open my game and it behaves like the game should. Now, whilst there is the good, let's not pretend it's all been sunshine and roses. In a normal environment, the thing you have to worry about with where your windows are placed is the workspace you're on. So I know this window is on workspace 1, this window, and let's say this window on workspace 2, and then we have, let's say, I don't know, something like this on workspace 3. This is relatively easy to keep track of because there is one variable that defines where invisible windows might be. The invisible windows in this case are on workspace 1 and workspace 2. When you're on a scrolling environment, you now have this infinite horizontal plane. And this means that you could spawn a window over here, be looking at this, and this is what's on workspace 1, this is what's on workspace 2, this is what's on workspace 3, and unless you remember there is a window off to the side, it's very easy to forget that you ever spawned that window. There have been a number of cases where I have spawned a duplicate terminal, where I've spawned a duplicate browser, I've spawned all of these different things, thinking I didn't have it open. And I did. I just didn't know where it was. And that's annoying, but fine for things like a terminal, a browser, and things where I can spawn a new instance of them. Discord, you can't do that. So I'll often click down here, click on Open Discord, and it does nothing, because the Discord window is open somewhere, but that somewhere, I don't know where it is. It turns out it was actually off to the side here, but I'd lost track of it. And I have done so on many occasions. This is not a one-time thing. This is probably at least once daily occurrence. Now, of course, this can be mitigated by having better windowing habits. So if I say I always want Discord to be over on my secondary monitor and I just keep it open off to the side, in that case, the problem goes away. In that case, the window's always going to be where I expect it to be. But if you don't have good windowing habits and you start using it in that way, like you were using a tiler where you can kind of get away with just spawning windows wherever, you will quickly start to realize that there is a lot more hidden complexity that you will have to get used to. And this has just been my experience with the model. This is something where it's really going to depend on how you personally interact with Windows. I can talk about what I do, I can talk about the problems that I come across, but you might not experience those problems and you might not experience those benefits because it's really going to depend on how you use your system. I think this is one of those models which may not be a best fit for everyone, but since there are so many plugins available for KDE, for GNOME, Hyprland, there's an i3 thing, there's a macOS thing, I think it's worth giving it a try and just seeing if you click with it. If you don't, hey, don't use it. That's totally fine. But if you do, it might completely change the way you use your system. But that's just my thought, and ultimately, hey, if you don't like it, you don't like it, and if you do, you do. But it is definitely worth a try. Give it a shot, try out Niri, try out any of these, and let me know what you think down below. If you liked the video, go like the video, go subscribe as well, and if you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe to Daily Therapy, linked in the description down below. That's gonna be it for me, and they see me scrolling.